promise to be as coherent and as fluent as my great predecessor, but I will try my best. I would like to start with something that happened exactly 40 years ago. 1976, I went for the first time abroad from Israel on my own. And it was a kind of one of those trips that you remember for life for more than one reason. First of all, I visited the city of Amsterdam and I fell in love, and it became my current home after many years. And that is not very important for this lecture, but for my life it was. And then I went to England, and in England I went to a small town called Paignton. It's in the south, near some place called Torquay, that often the residential weekend took place in some of them in recent years. And in 1976 I played a tournament in Paignton, a tournament which still takes place every year in September, in the house that was built by the inventor of the sewing machine, Singer. I don't remember his first name. Michael, no? Ah, sorry, this is what you said. I happened to win the tournament, first tournament I played abroad, but the most exciting thing was that after the tournament was finished, there was the chess reporter of a very important newspaper in England, the Telegraph, came to talk to me and take my game against the runner-up, who was an Australian player called Max Fuller. I think he passed away already. And what is the point of all this? The man, the reporter of the Telegraph, was Collins Mansfield. He lived in Paignton, and he was the chess correspondent of the Telegraph, among his other business. It was not his profession, but he did that. And that was, for me, already a great experience. Also, there were some great chess personalities in town, like Harry Golombek, B.H. Wood, and B.H. Clark, and others. And that was really something for me, because I knew all those names. Collins Mansfield gave me a book, a yellow book, that was written by Barry Barnes about him. So, of course, I asked him to sign the book. And I went with this book. I left Paignton on my way to my first Congress of Chess Composition, which was that year, in September, in the old capital of Denmark, which is called Ribe. And in Ribe, it was nothing to compare with nowadays congresses. It was a small congress, but I met some important names that I knew also only from above the diagrams in the magazine I used to receive. I was only 10 years in chess composition and in chess in general. And the congress was very nice and very exciting. There was not yet a solving contest, because that came 1 year after, in even bigger congress in Malinska, in Kirk. But the last day of the congress arrived, and I had to go back to Copenhagen and to spend the whole day in a terrible weather for somebody who comes from the Middle East. And I didn't know what to do. So I was sitting at the railway station, left the dog there and waiting for a train to come. I was the only one there, I think. And I didn't know really, I was not in the mood, when I saw suddenly three angels coming from nowhere. And three angels coming to me. One was Fadil Abdurrahmanovic, the second was Marian Kovacevic, and the third was Milan Velimirovic. And I saw them already. I saw some familiar faces. That was already some comfort. And they told me, "What are you doing here? Come with us." And they were heading to Copenhagen to meet Walter Jorgensen, a great Danish composer of the time. And I joined them, and I had one of the loveliest days I have ever had in there, and the family of Walter Jorgensen company. And that was the day where I met him in the Congress, but we did not speak, but that I really became friends with Milan Velimirovic, my friend for many, many years to come. Later, of course, I met him in many congresses. I was always inspired and impressed by not only by his great achievements and great knowledge, but also by his very warm personality, which I really cherish. And we had also something else in common. And when I approached my 60th birthday, I looked at some data, and I found out that Milan and also Christopher Jones from England, we were all born 1952, April 1952. So I got this nice idea to celebrate this jubilee with a big composing tourney with three sections. You can guess what the sections would be. And I proposed that to my not birthday mites, but almost birthday mites. Yeah? I was younger than Christopher Jones by a week and older than Milan also by a week or so. And I proposed that why not make this birthday together? And I was hoping to have favoring responses, but Milan told me something else. If I ever do such a jubilee, if I ever celebrate such jubilee with a composing tourney, it should be on the 64th birthday. 64th birthday is much more appropriate to do that. And I kept that in mind, but very unfortunately, Milan did not make it to the 64th birthday. But I kept it to do it on my 64th birthday, and also I was very happy to see that his friends organized this tournament, and we just got the title, the award on the booklet that we all received on the first day, and that I was really got excited when I saw that, and that was exactly what he would like. I heard about his the day that he passed away. I heard it from a great friend and also a great chess legend in Serbia. I think he was a friend of Milan. It was Ljubojevic. He told me that. And that was a big shock for me and for him as well. He was in the funeral, as far as I know, and he then said a few things in his memory. And I really want that we will all remember this great man, Milan Velimirovic, during this Congress, because He deserved this and much more than that, and his contribution to the chess composition is invaluable. And that's what I wanted to say, a few words in his memory. And then I would like to come to the topic of my mini lecture tonight. And this is about, of course, endgame studies. I celebrated not long ago not only my 64th birthday, but also exactly 50 years of chess career in various fronts. Because I published my first problems and studies 50 years ago, and also I played my first tournament, real tournament, 50 years ago. And ever since, I had a number of experiences connected with all these hobbies, and always across each other. So during those 50 years, there were many cases where there was a linkage between my games, other people's games, ideas I got in chess tournaments, and my composing, not of problems, but mainly of endgame studies, inspired by those experiences and also inspiring others. And that was always my special niche in the, because I belong always to both worlds. What I want to say is that nowadays we are struggling to promote the art of chess composition in general among young people and among the big market, potential market of chess players. And we are not very successful, and there are many reasons to that. First of all, we, as a kind of closed sect, we are not much interested in doing that. And we are happy to show our studies and problems to each other, and not much more than that. But art, if we see what we are doing as a kind of fine art, we should also think that art is for human being, is for the senses of the human, of you other people, and not for the drawer or only for colleagues or connoisseurs. And that I'm very sorry that recently, if I refer to my own genre, the endgame studies, it's becoming more problematic, because in the past we had classical authors who composed for the chess public players and solvers friendly endgame studies. And nowadays there are still such composers, but they are overwhelmed by intruders that all what they are interested is to show their silicon discoveries, and they compose studies which are sometimes pretty interesting, but even themselves they cannot fully understand them. I mean, more often I see composers showing their studies with an output of computer, because they cannot show, they don't understand their own studies, and that happens quite a lot, and that drives me real crazy, because we it's not about finding computer positions, or okay, it's also quite a tough job to find them too, but it has nothing to do with art. Art is only what you can, either people can, in our terms, solve, or at least comprehend, at least understand what they are seeing. And more often, the composers themselves fail to understand what actually they have composed. And that's bad. I would like to show you two examples of my own experiences with over-the-board chess, connected with my own studies, and to demonstrate in what way I try to popularize at least my genre among, it is easier than other genre, but there is still a lot to do with other genres too, among the huge chess public of millions of players that we fail to attract to our fine art, chess composition. Moment. Alma.
Okay.
this is the first study. As you see, it's not a miniature, and I was I played a couple of times. I played actually many tournaments in many chess tournaments in many countries, and in many of the those not in some of those tournaments, I was asked to dedicate an original endgame study to the event, just to promote the event in the chess press, and also to attract the players for one more out of the board, away of the board activity, just accompanying activity. And this is one of them which I dedicated to a tournament in London. There is every December, they organize a great tournament which is called London Classics in Olympia Halls in London. And I happened to play the tournament, but also to compose a study for the tournament. And I was staying in one of those bed and breakfast, you know, in London, that are very expensive, but they look sometimes like a cell in jail. You don't get, at least in jail, you don't pay for it so much, but because the bed is just occupying the whole room, and very difficult to maneuver there. There are many like this, and I was staying in one of those, and in the morning I was going to the famous breakfast, and then I was alone, but there was another table there with an old man and a young man, probably grandfather and grandson, and they were sitting there, and just there were very strange noises from that table. How it comes, that cannot be, and all kinds of these things. I was busy with my you know, beans and baked tomatoes, and but I was wondering what is the, was the noise about, and I was looking, and actually the grandson, the young boy, was showing his grandfather this endgame study, and they were really enjoying themselves with each and every move. This is, that was one of my greatest reward as a composer ever. It was more important than getting a prize in the tournament, and indeed we did not get a prize in the tournament, and that was my prize. I will show you the study, because that kind of studies might attract, as even the judge said,